Huawei has been positioning itself as a Chinese Nvidia for quite some time. And now they've just released a new AI GPU that is powering their new AI CloudMatrix. And this is the most powerful AI data center solution ever built in China using domestic technology. It almost doubles the performance of Nvidia's own solution. Think about it as the DeepSeek moment for AI data centers. I've spent the last decade designing computer chips, and I've been wondering how did they manage to pull this off despite the strict US export controls and SMIC's struggles with manufacturing. And what does it mean for the global AI race? Let me explain. US-China export controls on AI chips and semiconductor technology are clearly stimulating domestic developments in China. While Nvidia dominates globally, Huawei is designing an entirely parallel ecosystem for the Chinese market. And honestly, what they are doing, their solutions and their decisions are very interesting, and I will break it down today. In fact, they are establishing their own supply chain, starting from securing the wafer manufacturing to tools to chip design tools, all the way up to designing their custom silicon. Currently, the most competitive GPU designed in China is Huawei's Ascend 910C GPU. In fact, it's their answer to Nvidia's state-of-the-art Grade Blackwell 200 GPU. And now they're ready shipping it to customers. Let me break down their new GPU first, before we go all the way up to their new CloudMatrix 384. Looking at the design of the new Ascend 910C GPU, Huawei has followed a similar strategy to Nvidia's. They are shifting towards larger GPUs, one of the key trends in the industry. As AI models are growing exponentially in size and the amount of data is processed by AI models is also increasing, we are throwing more and more silicon in it. Here, Huawei followed Nvidia's approach with their Blackwell architecture. They've introduced a double die design. At the high level, there are two GPU dies linked by an interconnect bridge, with each die surrounded by four memories. That's how they've doubled the amount of compute and memory per GPU. Now, according to official specs, this new Huawei GPU delivers 800 teraflops of compute at 16-bit precision. Just for comparison, this is 4 times more powerful than Nvidia's H20, the most advanced chip Nvidia is allowed to sell in China. However, it's still 3 times less powerful than the GB200, the chip Huawei's new GPU ultimately aims to compete with. Nvidia's GPU also features the state-of-the-art memory, has higher memory bandwidth, and at least twice as efficient in terms of performance per watt. What's interesting, this new Huawei GPU is reportedly manufactured in 7 nanometers by TSMC. And we will talk more about this towards the end of the video. Now, Huawei didn't just build this GPU, they used it to power their new AI CloudMatrix 384. And what's interesting here, if in raw performance this new GPU is clearly behind Nvidia's GPU, its system-level architecture flips the game. In fact, Huawei did something quite crazy here. They went full optical. CloudMatrix 384, built out of 384 910C GPUs, and has been positioned as China's homegrown alternative to Nvidia's NVL72. Well, what is the trick here? If we look at Nvidia's system, we have 72 GPUs connected via NVLink. Here, they used 36 NVLink switches to interconnect all GPUs in the flat approach, allowing multiple GPUs to communicate with each other. And these connections are mostly electrical, meaning it's copper. And altogether, the system is capable of 180 petaflops of FP16 compute. But when we look at Huawei's new CloudMatrix, it's built of 384 GPUs, which is 5 times more GPUs. And with that, they've managed to almost double the performance of the system. And I think there is still room to scale it up further. Now, looking at the power efficiency, it doesn't look good. At the system level, the CloudMatrix consumes around 600 kW versus Nvidia's 145 kW. So Huawei solution, it's up 4 times more power. But why? First of all, the silicon itself is way less efficient, but the key difference comes from the system level. And here Huawei did something crazy. Both NVIDIA and Huawei having flat all-to-all architecture, meaning every GPU communicates with every other GPU. But the key difference is that Huawei relies on the optical links, not just between the racks, but between the GPUs as well. While NVIDIA uses mostly copper here for the NVL72. They have 1500 copper cables to interconnect all 72 Blackwell GPUs and NVLink switches within the rack, which significantly reduces the complexity and the cost. It's actually 6 times cheaper and way more power efficient than using optics here. Here they save roughly 20 kW of power per rack. However, Huawei went fully optical here. Just imagine, each of 384 GPUs optically connected to the network with multiple optical transceivers, meaning thousands of transceivers. So, going optical means huge bandwidth, so you can send a lot of data simultaneously. But these optical transceivers drain a lot of power. And it's a really challenge to maintain them, to maintain the system. It's really failure-prone. Now, you get the idea, right? Why Huawei's solution is so crazy and so complicated. That's why NVIDIA is now moving towards silicon photonics, so integrated solution, because it saves a lot of power. And if you want to know more, make sure to subscribe to the channel right now and then watch this deep dive episode on this later on. Now, before we continue to break down this new Huawei solution, some very interesting decisions they've made, let's first talk about tariffs. Trump recently announced a major tariff exemption for electronics to protect US consumers from price hikes and ease pressure for tech giants. While this sounds like good news, go to groundnews.com/Anastasi to properly understand how geopolitics shapes the future of technology. Founded by a former NASA engineer, Ground News built the only app and website bringing clarity to today's most critical issues. By gathering news from all around the world, then breaking down each source's political lean, credibility, and ownership, we can understand the biases driving each perspective. Here, you can sort through the hundreds of sources covering this exemption to see how some highly factual outlets frame this move as a huge sigh of relief for tech giants, while others expose how destabilizing Trump's tariffs have been. Most of you will see only one of these two perspectives on your typical news feed. Yet both are important on the conversation on how this trade war could impact NVIDIA's sales in China. The future of technology is becoming increasingly complex, and I believe Ground News is the great tool to find the most actual information on it. And because they're independent and funded by readers like us, I got for you an exclusive 40% off on their unlimited Vantage plan I've been using. Just go to groundnews.com/Anastasi or scan this QR code or click the link below. That's just $5 a month to see how credible resources report on technology, trade war, and other important aspects that impact our lives.
We have moved from a monolithic general-purpose computing platform to next-generation AI computing platform on CloudMatrix.
We've already discussed that Huawei went fully optical, using thousands of optical transceivers for direct connection between GPUs. They've explored it in greater detail in their recent paper, but there is a catch. Using that many optical transceivers, exploding the power consumption and the complexity of the system. So clearly this is not the direct one-to-one replacement to NVIDIA's state-of-the-art system, but for sure good enough to replace NVIDIA's H20 GPU. And they're still beating NVIDIA performance at the cluster, so at the system level. Yes, twice less efficient, but guess what? Chinese customers won't care much in this case about power consumption. Unlike the US and Europe, China is much less concerned about power limitations. In fact, the cost of energy in China is cheaper than in the US. And over the past few years, they've managed to greatly extend their power grid with renewables like solar, hydro, wind, and now nuclear. Unfortunately, their energy split is still not looking very good, with 50% of energy coming from burning coal and oil, and it's very polluting. Eventually, in the long term, the cost of intelligence will converge to the cost of energy. And this is another very important sector to invest in, and I also have it as a part of my portfolio. And here we are talking not just about renewables, but about infrastructure, storage, grid, resilience. Well, not just energy, but also water supply. We'll talk more about this towards the end of the video. Now, let me know your thoughts in the comments. This Huawei story, this DeepSeek moment for data centers, is a great illustration of something we've talked a lot on this channel, that nowadays is not about just building the best GPU. It's building the infrastructure, the system. NVIDIA CEO Jensen Huang says that NVIDIA is now an infrastructure company. And in the real world, systems and infrastructure matters more than chips. We see here that Huawei is clearly years behind in silicon, but they found a workaround in the system level, in the networking and in the software stack. And in general, China is very strong in software. The CloudMatrix runs on their proprietary CAN software stack. It is similar to NVIDIA's CUDA stack, but built for their GPUs, optimized for their NPUs, neural processing unit. NPU is a specialized part of silicon designed to accelerate AI tasks like matrix multiplication or tensor processing, and is built upon Huawei's proprietary DaVinci architecture. This CANN software stack handles everything from compilers to graph optimization to workload distribution across the hardware. And it plays a critical role in this new cloud matrix system. Because when system is complex and prone to failures, this software plays a critical role in making everything run smoothly. Well, at the moment, the next generation of Huawei's GPU, Ascend 910G GPU and 920 GPU are in production. And of course, I will share more details on it when available, so make sure to subscribe to the channel not to miss this big update. Still, manufacturing remains one of the biggest challenges for China. In fact, there have been reports that the 910C GPU dies that we've discussed today are apparently still manufactured by TSMC at 7 nanometers and brought to China. Well, I don't have any data to prove that. What we know for sure is that they're still heavily relying on the US and Europe for the most critical technologies and tools. And even though they're still figuring out the right recipe to come to the high yield in manufacturing, it's just a matter of time. Time, funding, and perseverance, which they have no shortage of. In the long term, it all will come down to the access to energy, abundant cheap energy, and water. I wrote a post about it on LinkedIn. If we are not connected yet, make sure to connect. Because water is another very critical resource for the planet as well as for data centers. Now, just think about it. A typical 100 megawatt data center consumes roughly 2 million liters per day. And of course, there are some recycling techniques, but it can't be recycled indefinitely. In the majority of the cases, around 70 to 80% is just evaporated. And that's quite harsh. Just think about the consequences of building a 2000 megawatt data center in the area with limited water resources. Not looking good. And China is exploring different ways to address it. For example, they've been experimenting with an underwater data center. The idea here, of course, is to reduce power consumption and the resources spent on cooling. In March this year, they've launched the first operational underwater AI data center off the coast of Sanya, Hainan. Just think about it. Placing data centers underwater allows for direct water cooling. But of course, the maintenance of this is a pure nightmare. In this case, repairs would require retrieving data center pods from the sea, meaning huge downtimes. And honestly, I hope it won't work, because this would have a huge negative effect on the marine ecosystem, and I don't want this to happen. Looking forward to reading your thoughts and feedback in the comments, and now check out this episode on NVIDIA going optical, or this one on a new quantum computer that runs on light. Please help this channel to grow by sharing this video with your friends and colleagues and on social media. I really appreciate it. Love you guys. Now I have to run to catch a plane. See you in the next one. Ciao.